Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the second semi-final of the New Zealand Initiative's Next Generation Debates. My name is Oliver Hartwig, and I'm the Executive Director of the New Zealand Initiative. Before we get started, I would like to thank the Friedlander Foundation for their very generous support for this project. Michael Friedlander is with us tonight, and he's been a long-standing background supporter of many projects designed to improve public understanding of why public policy matters, and without market support, this tournament wouldn't have happened. So thank you very much, Michael. The aim of the tournament is to get people, especially young people, thinking and talking about public policy issues and understanding why they matter. As most of you know, the New Zealand Initiative's mission statement is promoting sound public policies that will make for a better standard of living for all New Zealanders. To give you some background on tonight's event, university debating teams consisting of two of the top debaters from Auckland, Victoria, Canterbury and Otago universities entered the tournament, and heats were held last week in Auckland and Wellington High Schools. This is our second semi-final. We had the other one in Wellington last night on euthanasia, and the grand final on our property market will be held on the 19th of August, so next week, in Wellington. The mood tonight is this House believes that economic growth always comes at the expense of people and the environment. I should hasten to explain that the position reflected in the Moot is designed to make for a good debate and does not necessarily reflect the view of the New Zealand Initiative. I should also say that the teams were assigned their side of the debate with a toss of a coin. So before we begin, let me introduce you to our speakers. From the University of Auckland, arguing the affirmative side, we have Paul Smith. Paul completed a BA in History, Politics and Philosophy at Victoria University and then defected to the University of Auckland to study towards a master's degree in philosophy. He is the president of the Auckland University Students Association and has been debating since before most of the school students here were born. He has debated in international university competitions in locations as exotic and diverse as Botswana, South Korea, India, and Invercargill. Please welcome Paul Smith. Paul is joined by Jessica Story, and Jessica is a fifth-year University of Auckland student studying towards a degree in majoring in French and politics. She is the Education Vice President of the Auckland University Students Association and has been involved in debating since high school. She was a quarter-finalist at the World Universities Debating Championship in Chennai in 2014, and she reached the finals of both the New Zealand Prepared Debating Championships and the New Zealand Impromptu Debating Championships. So please welcome Jessica Story. And from the University of Canterbury, arguing the negative side, we have George Mander. George is in his third year at Canterbury University studying law and science, which he hopes to combine as a career through international environmental law. George started debating in year 7 and has been a part of the Canterbury Schools regional debating team since 2012. He's won the James Butchart Cup in 2013 and had been selected as a reserve for the South Island novice debating team in 2014. George is currently the Vice President of the University of Canterbury Debating Society and an adjudicator for the Canterbury Schools Debating Council, a member of the Christchurch Youth Council and the winner of the senior mooting competition in law at UC. Please welcome George Mander. He's joined by Robert Cooper, and Robert is a fourth-year law and economics student at Canterbury University. He's been debating since high school and won the Junior Regional Press Cup in year 10. Robert has recently participated in the World's University Debating Tournament in Malaysia, among other tournaments, and this year he is the treasurer for the University of Canterbury Debating Society, so please welcome Robert Cooper. Finally, our adjudicators tonight are Alex Sinclair, a barrister at Short & Chambers, Joshua Baxter, a solicitor at Russell McVeigh, and Johanna McDevitt, a solicitor at Simpson Grierson. Please welcome our adjudicators. The rules for the debate tonight are very simple. Each speaker has 7 minutes with a bell at 6 and a final bell at 7 minutes. Each team has a reply of 4 minutes with a bell at 3 minutes and a final bell at 4. There will be no points of order or information, but interjections are acceptable at the discretion of the chair, which is me. And again, tonight's mood is this House believes that economic growth always comes at the expense of people, and the environment, and starting for the affirmative is the University of Auckland. Over to you.
In 1930, an economist named John Maynard Keynes wrote a piece, a short book called The Economic Possibilities for Our Grandchildren. His prediction was that productivity gains and economic growth over the next 100 years would lead to 15-hour working weeks for all, more time for leisure, pleasure, and the development of a flourishing human culture and life. I can't imagine how sad he'd be to see the state of the world as it is today. We've had the growth, we've had the productivity gains, but people are not liberated. Millions, if not billions, are still wage slaves to insecure jobs and even longer hours, particularly in America. And our Earth is slowly crumbling under the pressure that we're putting on it. The answer given to us by Milton Friedman in the 50s, 60s and 70s, and by the ACT Party and think tanks today, is that more economic growth is the answer. And this debate is about that, about whether unrestricted economic growth has harms to people and to the environment. And we're going to be fighting that on two fronts, and to say that unrestricted economic growth has led to a rise in inequality, which hurts people, and it's also hurt the environment to the extent we're reaching the tipping point. In that case, we think the debate's quite clear. It's not about going through 1,000 different examples from here or there about whether there's one or two on the margins that help show that economic growth helped people. It's about the general rules and forces underlying it. So first, what do we mean by economic growth? Well, the wide common usage adopted by neoclassical economists, which is filtered through, is that it's about GDP growth, about the value at market prices of all final goods and services purchased in an economy, and increasing that value correlates to increasing economic growth. And the thing to note there is that increasing production and increasing consumption is something that counts and pushes towards that sort of economic growth. It's often used as a rough measure of development and well-being. In practice, we say it captures neither. The forces underlying this are particularly harmful to humans and the environment, particularly because those sorts of costs, the social costs of inequality, the social costs of large-scale unemployment and class stratification, aren't things which figure in profit-driven business decisions which tend to push economic growth. But secondly, to the extent where the environment is and the exploitation of that is highly used for pushing economic growth and increasing production, and to that extent, it's often not costed on the basis that the environment seen as belonging to all and part of the commons rather than being part of people's general rather than belonging to individual people. So let's talk about economic growth and inequality here, because part of the question is, where does the growth go? And the facts almost prove our case, because the United States has seen 60% economic growth since 1970. You'd think that would help people. In fact, the distribution of wealth has changed. It's now 84% of people, so 84% of the wealth is owned by the top 20% of people in the United States. And the bottom 40% of people there own 0.3% of the total wealth. You've also seen pay massively increase. From 1970, it was your average CEO earned 20% of your average, 20 times your average worker. Now it's 354 times your average worker. You've also seen mobility decrease. New Zealand too has become one of the worst countries in the OECD on the basis of inequality. We've seen that since 1980, the average pay of the 80th percentile has increased over that of people at the 20th percentile lower down in the scale. This sort of inequality has real social harms. It correlates with higher rates of social problems, so health problems, mental illness, crime, in the communities who are on the lower rungs, and lower rates of educational achievement and social mobility for them. It correlates with less social cohesion, because we know that more equal societies are more trusting, more empathetic, and tend to treat their citizens better, but it also correlates with lower rates of happiness, because the less equal your society is, the less people are invested in it and believe that their own lives are good, even if their absolute standards of living are rising. And what's economic growth got to do with all this? Well, the first thing is, it's not solving anything, because we have had 60% economic GDP growth in the United States, and barely any of that has trickled down to the 80% of people who aren't able to access any of the benefits of it. But secondly, it's breaking trends. The assumption was long that economic growth was a result of productivity growth, which would also drag wages along with it, because as workers became more productive, they would be paid more. That was true until 1970. Since then, you've seen 74% rise in productivity gains for workers, but only a 9% rise in average wages. And the reality is that economic growth and unrestricted economic growth has been increasingly captured by those people at the top. Why? Because they have the capital now to leverage the opportunities in large markets that bring the largest returns for them, so they're able to capitalize on the biggest slice of the economic growth we see. So they not only are they benefiting from what seems like economic growth for the formation far disproportionately, they're increasing inequality, which is a cost to real people at the on the bottom levels. But secondly, they're able to invest much more human capital for themselves and their children and their friends. And their networks become much more important as there are a decreasing amount of opportunities for people who aren't part of that class. And that's why 65% of Americans who are born in the bottom 40% of America will stay there, and why 65 to 70% of Americans who are born in the top 20% and the top 40% will stay there for the rest of their lives, and their children will as well. So we think to that extent that economic growth hasn't solved those problems, but a focus on unrestricted economic growth actually encourages them, because people who are already well positioned to take advantage of that do. Let's talk now about the environment. Because we know that we'll be told by that side of the house that the appropriate way to deal with climate change and environmental damage is to keep on growing, to get to the point where we can mitigate it. But mitigation never provides the answer. The damage is already done. It's not a matter simply of learning to live with it. And why was the damage done? The damage was done because economic growth over the last two centuries has been focused on increasing production and increasing consumption and exploiting natural resources to the extent where those resources are no longer able to be provided for most people in the future. Because on the 20th of July, we heard a very stark warning that all of the predictions that we've had so far, and this is from NASA, all of the predictions we've had so far were incorrect about global warming, that it's actually far worse than we ever thought it was, that the sea level will rise 10 times faster than we thought and be over 3 metres a sea rise by 2065. And an increasing focus on unrestricted economic growth only drives this further, not only because economic growth to a large extent is often dependent on increasingly exploiting resources, increasing production to fuel that growth, it's also the kind of thing which we say undermines attempts to regulate it or prevent it. Why? Well, the first reason is that when you have a strong and sustained economic growth, which is captured by small amounts of wealthy people, that tends to mean that they also have a large amount of political sway. So they're able to change, they're able to capture the sort of regulations and evade them. All of the sorts of going-ons that we see in America and the Senate and the House on the basis of people like pork barrel politics and the sorts of concessions that people make to the rich to prevent and undermine that. But secondly, often it's not costed. It's not the cost to the environment from the degradation of the Californian water cycle in that case, but also to the Amazonian rainforest and the range of other economic degradation we had doesn't figure necessarily as a cost on those balance sheets, and it's hard to make it do so. So in this case, we've seen economic growth be the main engine for the destruction of the environment. We don't see it being a solution on this side of the House we're proud to propose.
The problem with a lot of the affirmative team's arguments is the idea that economic growth is an end rather than a means. And that's not what we think on this side of the house. So we think that when you want to use an example from the 1930s and examples from America, we'd like to point you to examples from East Asia, from India, where poverty is at an all-time low. Even in New Zealand, where life expectancy has increased dramatically. We'd like to point you to examples such as from the 1930s where people were saying, we're running out of food, we're using all the coal, and those problems aren't there anymore. So what we'd like to talk about is a sort of two-pronged attack against the affirmative's argument. Firstly, we're going to tell you why economic growth doesn't cause the sort of problems they've talked about. And secondly, we're going to tell you why economic growth can actually help people and help the environment and further to what they want to talk about. And rebuttal will be integrated in this. Before I get into first the people and then secondly the environment, first I'm going to talk to you about what growth actually looks like and not the sort of evil version of growth that Paul wanted to talk about. Because what growth actually looks like is an increase in innovation, an increase of technology. It's not pillaging resources, taking all your coal from the mines, that sort of thing. We see growth, it is an increase in GDP, so an increase in expenditure, but that comes with an increase in health, an increase with wealth, increased happiness, opportunity, leisure, luxury, all those sorts of things. When GDP rises, we see that those sorts of things rise as well, because there's more productivity, more technology, more innovation, and these allow more opportunities for people and more funds available to put into good areas of society. And we think that innovation is the key area we need to look at when we look about economic growth, especially today in the modern society we live in, because a lot of the problems that Paul talked about may have been prevalent in the 1930s, but we've solved them through the growth we've had since then. And as Henry Ford once said, when people come to him and ask what he asked what they wanted, they would have told him a faster horse. What we say is that innovation is the key to getting things to a better place than they are today. And that the affirmative may not realise that right now, but we do on this side of the house. So firstly, I'm going to tell you about people and why economic growth doesn't come at the expense of people. So firstly, we don't think it does come at the expense of people because we don't think innovation, that sort of thing, hurts people. For example, when the MRI scanner was invented, that caused a huge increase in economic growth. It caused, you know, a lot of money coming in for people who wanted to buy that, who wanted to create machines and sell them and that sort of thing. And furthermore, it didn't hurt people at all. That technology was invented without, you know, putting people in a worse position. In fact, it put people in a lot better position because medical care increased. So this is the second idea, that when this growth comes in ways that don't hurt people, such as innovation, that it in fact helps increase people's standard of living. So what we say is that when we look at statistics such as life expectancy in New Zealand or education rates, we can see that they increase significantly when economic growth does. For example, in the 1800s, the average life expectancy for somebody living in New Zealand was 35 years. Now it is over 80 today. And another example, the average amount of education that somebody would be getting maybe 30 years ago was 8 years or 7.9 years. Now it's 14. So we see that these sorts of things have dramatically increased. So we don't think it's okay to say, when Paul wants to talk about rise in inequality, rise in problems with distribution of wealth, we don't think that that's a fair harm when all their problems are relative and not absolute. So what do I mean by this? I mean that all their arguments are that inequality exists more now relative to other people in society, so that perhaps the person with more money than you now has slightly more money than you did originally. But what do we mean by absolute? We mean that now that you're in a better position, regardless of how far ahead someone is than you. So how do you, we don't think that you can measure like happiness in a relative way like this, because it would be much easier to say that, you know, you're not happy because someone's got a faster car than you, so you have to go buy a faster car but you can't afford it. And that's the sort of problem they want to talk about. What we want to talk about is that now people have much better standards of living. So we have more heated homes, we have more power, we have more food, that sort of thing. And we don't think that being relatively unhappy because, or relatively unequal rather, because somebody has more of that than you is a significantly bad thing when everyone's standard of living has increased. So we think that when people are more comfortable due to a better infrastructure, because that's what growth leads to, right? It leads to more innovation, more technology, and more funding. So that means better infrastructure, for example, heating, power, that sort of thing, and it leads to more funds, for example, people who are earning more money and producing more money. And that's what happens if economic growth happens. The GDP increases, so you've got more money coming in. That leads to more money being able to be allocated towards supporting the poor, towards supporting supporting the people who need the money. So we think that smaller amounts of people living in poverty is a great benefit, and we need them to tell us why that isn't okay if people are relatively unhappy. So secondly, onto the environment, because we've got a couple of responses to this, because a lot of their material focused on climate change, the exploitation of resources and that sort of thing. And we have two responses to this. Firstly, the problem with exploitation and stuff, that wasn't due to growth, that's due to insufficient property rights. So we think that when you talk about exploitation and tragedy of the commons and like all the mines being used up and all the fish being taken, that comes when there's inefficient property rights. And when you've got a society that has had growth and that is in a position to step back and look at what resources it has, rather than people who are starving and need fish, that sort of thing, you are in a better position to have clear property rights and lead to more sustainable economic growth. For example, when New Zealand introduced the fishing quotas, we saw overfishing decrease because people were more interested in preserving those quotas, using those in the future, that sort of thing, rather than just fishing them to feed their people. Now, secondly, innovation. As I've said, innovation doesn't come at the cost of the environment. And that's the sort of growth we want them to address today. That why somebody working in the University of Otago Medicine Lab creates the cure for a common cold, makes millions of dollars, brings all that growth into New Zealand. We want them to tell us why that's bad for the environment or bad for people. And secondly, what this growth actually allows us to do is then move forward and help the environment. So Paul preemptively talked about this and talked about, you know, the damage is already done. But I'd like to point you to an example of London in the 1900s where you could be, where it was described of a pea soup of smog over all the houses that had coal power. What happened then is that London's growth allowed them to outlaw coal fires because they were rich enough at that stage to ban them all and provide alternative forms of heating. So we think that all the harms that they talk about are able to be overcome when you have more infrastructure, when you have more funding available. And all their harms are quite old-fashioned, if you like. So what we think is that without economic growth, life may be simpler, but it won't be better or easier. People won't be absolutely better. They may be more relatively unequal under growth, but we think that as long as everyone is doing better, that's the only harm we're willing to accept.
That side of the house wants you to believe that the more things you have, the more happiness you will have. Effectively, that the more absolute goods you can have, the happier you will get, and that that goes on and on ad infinitum, and that it will never stop. And that the more hair straighteners you have, the happier you might be, and the more that will add to your life. But in reality, we know from all the statistics and from the way that people today are less happy than they were prior to World War II, that more economic growth doesn't necessarily lead to more happiness. What it does lead to, which is something that they never responded to, is that it leads to increasing inequality and to an increasing gap between the rich and the poor. And that's precisely the kind of thing that does lead you to query your lot in life, to feel like maybe you're not worth something, to feel like you're not worth as much as your neighbour or, in fact, somebody living three suburbs away from you, and that you'll never, ever be able to reach that point. But more than that, our increasing obsession with things that can be valued in terms of monetary terms, in terms of what we will pay for them, means that we roll over, we crush things in life that might mean more than they balance on a spreadsheet, right? When it comes to the environment, when it comes to future generations to live on this planet or to enjoy the natural beauty that we enjoy day after day, although increasingly less so. But also when it comes to the things that we do for benevolent purposes, rather than just because they have a monetary value. The kind of things that are undervalued in a system that looks at GDP as the greatest driver and the greatest measure of a country and what it has to contribute. So, four things to talk about, even. You're very lucky. Firstly, growth and what it means. Secondly, whether absolute wealth is actually such a great thing. Thirdly, the environment, which they wanted to skate over. And fourthly, what this means for culture and less valued things. So let's talk about growth. Because what they said to you is that, in fact, they're happy to support growth that doesn't just talk about an increase in coal, but instead talks about productivity and innovation, which are apparently always good things. We say that's not actually the case. We're not prepared to accept that. Because when you're looking to increase your growth or your productivity or whatever, it's easy to skate over the things that are intangible and don't measure. So when we're trusting businesses and the like to make the decisions that grow our country and we're refusing to regulate on that basis, we're allowing the decision to rest with people who are less likely to look at the cost to the people that they're skating over. So we think that, in fact, things like an increase in coal, like extracting all our natural resources in the short term and that kind of short-term thinking, is exactly the kind of thing we incentivize when we focus on GDP, because it's about what you can gain in the short run, about how fast that growth can be, and about how good that looks on paper. So we think they do have to support an increase in extraction of natural resources, like we've seen in the last 100 years, that kind of exponential growth. But secondly, we're a little confused about the idea that increased innovation is always a good thing and never harms anybody, because all they did to illustrate this point was talk about MRIs and to say that that was a really good innovation, therefore innovation is good. But like, the innovation that created asbestos wasn't necessarily a good innovation, right? That harmed people. So you can't point to one example and say that that knocks it out of the park. So we say that actually, lots of the kind of technological innovation they want to talk about do have extreme short-term harms on people. As technology increases and people are made more and more replaceable and they no longer have a job and they're no longer needed and they don't have the skills that are required to get them up into the upper earning sections, we think that they get more and more locked out. They're placed at the bottom, they can't escape there, and they're increasingly not needed or valued by society. The need for their labour has been replaced with our obsession with capital and our ability to make money off that. So not happy to stand for that kind of growth. So then let's move on to what they were talking about when it came to absolute wealth. Because what they want to rest their hands on is this idea that they're more concerned about people's absolute standard of living than about their relative one. We say, firstly, we don't actually agree that an increase in absolute standards of living leads to more happiness, like I talked about earlier, and we'd like to hear a response to that. But we say that, secondly, even if you do have more material goods, which is what they want to hang their hat on, that doesn't stop you from being in a worse position. If it is the case that you have less chance of accessing a good job that will give you some kind of happiness or fulfillment, that you have less chance of accessing a good education, but also that you have less access to actually having a legitimate say in your political system because you're outclassed by those with more money and therefore more sway, then all of those things mean that you are in an absolute worse position than otherwise. But more than that, they didn't deny the fact that increasing growth leads to massively increasing income inequality. They just tried to pretend this wasn't such a big deal. Let's talk about why it is. We say that firstly, this kind of income inequality undermines social mobility, which appeals to our basic sense of fairness. It means that wealth entrenches wealth and people have almost no ability to escape the lot that they were born with. They're increasingly stratified and they're increasingly kept down. And this also means that the benefits they wanted to talk about, things like increasing life expectancy, only accrue to those who are on top in society. In fact, people in the lower strata of our society have lower life expectancy, poorer education, lower health rates, sometimes lower than people at the very bottom of society did 20 years ago. And we think the consequences of that are a loss of hope, a loss of self-worth, that you look at yourself and you think that you are inherently inferior. And we think that's very problematic for your happiness. But then let's also talk about this decrease in happiness. Because if what they were saying is true, with our ability to buy more and more things and have iPhones and hair straighteners and all these new gadgets, you would expect us to all be so much happier. But in fact, there are diminishing returns on how happy we get out of stuff. And that's why our happiness hasn't actually increased since World War II. Because we're actually more concerned with relative wealth, by how happy we feel compared to someone else, by how well we think we've done in life, by how well we look compared to somebody across the road. And so we think that when they're prepared to support that kind of income inequality, you actually don't get any gain in happiness. This is particularly true when you lead to huge amounts of social segregation. When other people live in different areas to you, have different access to education and workplaces, and as a result have completely different interests, and you're unable to continue to interact with them. So we think that that kind of thing leads to a society where there is a lot of social cost, and we don't think that it leads to the increase in happiness they want to stand by. So let's then quickly talk about environmental issues. Because Paul told you about the massive harms of this, and the fact that we're reaching the end of the Earth's usable resources. Their response to that was to point to the fact that we've put in place regulation in London to slow down economic growth in order to improve the environmental impact of what London was doing, which we think is precisely what you have to do. It's the industrialised nations, the ones with the most growth, that have the most harm to our planet. We think that, in fact, smaller, less industrial countries with less growth don't have that kind of impact. And we say at the end of this debate that the fact that they think people in Western countries are big enough and smart enough following all this growth to solve these problems doesn't help the people in California with no access to water. Quite happy to propose.
So it was ironic that Paul stood up at the start of his speech and said this debate wasn't about coming up with a lot of examples, and then proceeded to base his example almost entirely on America. Well, here's what we have to prove to you today is that growth in America causes harm to people and the environment. It's that not all growth has to come at the expense of those people, of that environment. And we've got examples that prove that actually this isn't the case. Here's why. Two points of clash. Firstly, people, is it going to harm them? Secondly, the environment, is it going to harm it? Firstly, people. On the affirmative side of the house, we heard a lot of examples from America like people in the lowest bracket stay in the lowest bracket. Well, we've got two responses to that. Their entire case was predicated on the assumption that there's going to be this increased inequality when we see growth. We don't see, first of all, that that's the case. Certainly, it's not universally the case. Right here in New Zealand, we don't see that happening. Right here in New Zealand, we see that absolute poverty has declined between 1953 and 2011, but furthermore, there's reduced inequality now than what there was back in 1953. We see that there has been none of the stagnation of income mobility that we see in the US. We see that 75% of those in the bottom 20% of our income brackets move to a higher decile within 8 years. we don't see the sort of stagnation that we see in other countries like America. What we have to prove to you today is that not economic growth does not always come at the expense of people, always come at the expense of the environment. We definitely don't see it coming always at the expense of people. We see that 25% of those in the bottom 20% in New Zealand move up to the top 50% within 8 years. We don't see this income this stagnation of income mobility. We see, what does this mean? It means that we don't see the increasing inequality that their entire case about people was predicated on. We don't see the increasing inequality that leads to decreased happiness. We don't see the increasing inequality that leads to decreased trust. Furthermore, they wanted to talk to you about how inequality leads to decreased political sway. Well, first of all, we don't see that inequality in New Zealand. I'll say it again. We don't see that inequality in New Zealand. Or we don't see the increase in inequality as a result of growth in New Zealand. And second of all, we don't see that there's a huge amount of corruptness within countries like New Zealand, and we don't see that it's always the case that you're going to get this reduction in political sway as a result of increasing inequality. But mainly, we don't see that there's going to be increasing inequality. Furthermore, we spoke to you a lot about how absolute wealth was more important than this increase in inequality, even if that were the case. We see that once you have people that are able to provide a basic standard of care for their families, then we see that they're going to be happier than if they're, regardless of whether their neighbour is wealthier than them or not. We see that it's more important for people to have the basic needs. What they require is to have this a higher standard of living overall, regardless of whether you see inequality, and we don't see that inequality recurring in any case. Now let's talk about the environment. We heard from Jess at the start that Rob skated over it. Well, she's covered it in about the last 10 seconds of her speech, so we don't see that there's a great deal of onus on that either. Well, what do we see? We heard from her in the brief period of time she spent covering it that we're not going to get measuring of the intangibles. We're not going to get this improved environment. We came up with concrete examples today, like the smog in London, and that show that these things are not intangibles. And furthermore, that once you stop having a population that is struggling to make ends meet, you have a population that can afford to care about the environment. Because the thing that people will care about first is putting food on the table for their families. The thing that people will care about first is making sure that they have an adequate standard of living. Once you have that, you get people that are able to care about the environment. And what's more, you get people that can afford to do something about it. Because a lot of this environmental care takes money, and you don't get that money unless you have growth. You need to have money coming in to be able to do something to fix the environment. Secondly, we heard that asbestos was not a good thing, and this came about as a result of growth. Well, I'd like to point out that, in fact, the onus on us is not to show that growth is always good. It's to show that growth is not always bad. So coming up with one example where growth may have incentivized one product that was potentially bad is not actually going to win them the debate. Let's also talk about scarcity. Well, we heard that we're going to see overexploitation of scarce resources when we have economic growth. We don't see that this is the case. We see that the markets control this. And how does this work? Well, we look at the work of someone like Harold Hotelling, I believe is how you pronounce his name. And he spoke about how when you get scarce resources, then once you get down to a point where they're becoming severely limited, then you get the price driving up. When that price drives up because there's less supply, then basically you get other alternatives becoming more affordable in relation to those other products. So we see that the sorts of resources that are becoming scarce will be outcompeted by alternatives, which will be incentivized by the market by growth. We see that growth will occur, and this is going to be to provide alternatives through the market system. Finally, I'd like to talk briefly about property rights and how if you have property rights, then essentially you have this protection of the environment. Because we saw when you had problems like whaling that one of the problems was that there wasn't incentives to whale sustainably, because if you don't kill that whale, then someone is going to kill it tomorrow and they're going to take that profit away from you. If you own a portion of sea, if you own a fishing quota, you own the whales, then you're incentivized not to hunt all of them all at once. You're incentivized to protect your income in the future, and you're incentivized to sell it when the price is higher, perhaps when they're more scarce. Sorry, that's not the wording I was... You're incentivized to wait to sustain your income now and in the future, and that means that you get greater conservation. We see that people are better off when there's growth. You get better absolute standards of living, and you don't get the inequality that the negative side of the house is talking about. Certainly not in all cases. Maybe in America, not here. We're proud to oppose. Thank you.
Increases in GDP and economic growth are very correlated to increases in health, standards of living, increases of education and that sort of thing. And though this side of the house may rest a case on the fact that correlation isn't causation, you know, we believe that sometimes it may be pointing very suggestively at that thing. So Auckland today want to tell you that growth always hurts people and that always harms the environment. At the end of the day, we don't have to prove that innovation is always good or whichever onus just wanted to push on us. What we have to tell you is that simply this isn't true, that growth always hurts the environment and people. And what we've done is we've done this and more. We've told you that growth can come, you know, free of environmental harms or free of harms on people through innovation, that sort of thing. Furthermore, what we've done then is we've then gone on to show you why growth can actually help people and can help the environment. So we've actually addressed this on two levels. So I'm going to talk about the people and environment once again, but first I'll just attack this innovation idea very quickly, because at the end of the day, we're not here to prove that innovation is always great. That's not what we're here to debate. What we're here to tell you is that innovation is a form of economic growth, that sustainable farming, for example, is a form of economic growth. And these sorts of forms of economic growth don't have to hurt the environment. They don't have to hurt the people. So these forms do exist. And what we'd like Auckland to do at the end of the day is to tell you why these things aren't, you know, good forms of growth and why they do hurt the environment and people. So I'd like to talk about the people now. And because, as Robert Fogel, an economist, once said, if life expectancy meant only an additional decade of, you know, poor health and unhappiness, then we wouldn't be celebrating it and researching it. So therefore, we must have a reason for increasing our life expectancy if that's something we've been focusing on. So we don't think that Auckland's all this material about people being unhappy is very convincing, especially when they haven't given us a measure of happiness, how they know people are happier, were happier in the past, that sort of thing. What we say at the end of the day is that medicine has pushed back, you know, diseases from older age. Disabilities are more easily catered for with better infrastructure these days. So we see that when medical technology has increased, people's, you know, health has increased, people's life expectancy has increased, and this is a positive growth for the people. This is something that doesn't harm people, and in fact helps them. For example, people now work in safer jobs because better safety practices have emerged as industries grew. We see that these sorts of things, they don't harm people, they help people. We'd like Auckland to tell you in their reply why they harm people through this. And it's not enough for Jess to stand up and say that we're advocating hair straighteners on this side of the debate, because what we're advocating is better nutrition, better education, power, heating, those sorts of things that come through an economy doing well, that come through more growth, that don't come when you stagnate. And on the idea of the environment, because we've had two ideas from the affirmative on this. Firstly, coal mines are bad when you exploit them, that sort of thing, and there's not enough water in California. We've got two responses to this. Firstly, coal mines, we told you this wasn't the fault of economic growth. This was the fault of inefficient property rights. We don't think it's fair to point to economic growth as the cause, where if there was efficient property rights, we could see sustainable growth in the form we've talked about, innovation, better technology. In terms of the water in California, we thought this was a bit of a weird point because growth doesn't cause droughts. But what we'd like to say in response to that is that if you have a lot of money due to economic growth, you're much better placed to buy more pipes, to build more infrastructure, to get the water out there. So we see that environment can be helped through more funds, more economic growth. At the end of the day, asbestos may not be good, but do you know what is good? MRI scans, Panadol, pacemakers, heart transplants, all these things that came from innovation and growth. The list goes on. We'd like to know where Auckland's list is, other than in the 1930s America they want to talk about. We think that economic growth is a good thing. It does help people. It does help the environment. It doesn't always have to harm them. We'd like to know from that side of the house and their reply why it always does harm them.
Watching from on high, or from down below, depending on your view of his economics, Keynes would have seen little in this debate to change his mind, aside from being maybe a little comforted by the existence now of MRI machines. The question of this debate was economic growth and what it has done. It was never a debate about this side of the house wanting to go back to caves, to ban MRI machines, to throw away healthcare. It was a question about chasing ever greater economic growth and removing restrictions on it, or a question about recognising the costs it imposes on people and the environment and slowing it down through all sorts of regulations that people on that side of the house don't like. We say on the side of the house that economic growth absolutely should be restricted and channeled. It shouldn't be laissez-faire. We say there are a number of reasons why that is. Now look first at inequality. We told you that that matters. We told you that the United States has seen a 60% GDP increase since 1970, a 74% productivity gain for your average worker, but that hasn't channeled down. And although there has been an absolute increase in living standards, which is what they wanted to hang their hat on, people aren't as concerned as they are about absolute standards when it comes to countries like the United States and like New Zealand, where we've also seen growth in inequality. They are concerned about how equal they are, because more equal societies are healthier, have less crime, have greater social cohesion, more opportunities for people, and are happier. And that comes from the research on this, Canterbury. Having a washing machine and hating your life is not necessarily a better outcome. In that case, we don't think that absolute standards are the sorts of things that people respond to. And they didn't respond to all of the harms and the social harms and costs of rising inequality that we pointed to. They told you at second they've merely closed their eyes because they must have been to say that New Zealand has no inequality. Since 1980, your person in the 20th percentile gets paid far less comparatively to the person in the 80th percentile who's far above them across a period of time where we've experienced economic growth and it hasn't gone to the people it needed to go to. What was their next response? Well, guys, it's all about innovation because you on the affirmative team hate MRI machines. Well, we don't. Our point was that these sorts of things and these sorts of innovations, first of all, aren't necessarily all to do with rampant economic growth, because it's not the sons and daughters of the elite in America who are going, you know what's great? Daddy earned an extra $5 million this year, so I'm going to go and invent some great healthcare tool. There's no necessary connection between large percentages of economic growth that are captured by small percentages of other people. We'll bargain that innovation in the healthcare industry happens either way, even if we have slower rates of growth on the basis that we make people more equal. But furthermore, so on that basis, we're not going to accept that they're going to get away with saying there is only one case that we can cite where growth has helped people's lives and not hurt the environment and people, and therefore by the wording of the motion we win, because we can show it's not literally true that economic growth always hurts people. On to environmental degradation. Their response was that when you can afford it, you'll tend to protect the environment. Well, who can afford it, right? Because America is chewing through the environment at ever-increasing rates. By their standards, they have the basics like food and nutrition, but they keep doing it. Why? Because they're caught in a rat race where they have to produce more and more and consume more and more to keep GDP growth going, right? Because it's about the value of the economy. It's not about happiness and innovation and all the measures they told you. It's about the wealth of the things that are bought and sold in your economy and the value of those. But furthermore, when you have social inequality, you feel like you don't have the basics, so you keep consuming. We're way better off than we were in 1980 or 1950, but I still want a new iPhone. I have an iPhone 4, probably fine, much better than the old phone in 1950, but I want a new one because of the fact that my friends have one and other people do around me, and those possibilities are made available. So we never make the point where we have the basic standards to start protecting the environment, we continue to destroy it. Next point, ridiculous. There's a natural limit proven by an economist. Might be literally true about whales, right? Yes, we'll fish them until they're almost gone and then we can't find the last one in the Atlantic and we'll stop. But the problem is there's an environmental cost that's not part of that equation, which is no more whales, a destroyed ecosystem. Then we'll shift to sharks until we have no more sharks. Correct, we might not entirely destroy the species, but we'll wreck the ecosystem in it. And that was the entire point we were pushing with you. Unrestricted economic growth hurts people and it hurts the environment. We've got to accept much slower growth to protect people, to ameliorate those social costs and protect the environment. Property rights aren't going to do it. We are on the side of the house. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think you will agree with me that we have indeed heard a very good debate from both our teams from Canterbury and Auckland. A debate about MRI scanners, asbestos and hair straighteners, of course, and of course about economic growth. So please join me in thanking our two debating teams from Canterbury and Auckland. Now, the adjudicators have just withdrawn. and I would like to ask you to take a seat in the audience. And I would like to invite our two panelists for tonight's debate, Dr. Sue Bradford and Sir Roger Douglas, to join me on the panel. Now, what we're doing in this debating tournament, we are always inviting two expert commentators to provide their insights, their views, their expertise on the subject, and share with us their thoughts on the debate. We're always trying to make sure that the two panelists we invite are at least marginally different. I think we succeeded. The other good thing about tonight's panelists is that they hardly need any introduction, but I will introduce them anyway. So we're very glad to be joined by Dr. Sue Bradford, who is, of course, an activist, an academic, and a former politician who served as a list member in Parliament, representing the Green Party from 1999 to 2009. Sue has just completed a doctoral research project, which led her to conclude that there is room for multiple think tank-like initiatives on the New Zealand left. And as we at the New Zealand Initiative are great believers in competition, we certainly welcome Sue to the scene and wish her well in her efforts. Sue told me before the event that they are still looking for a name for this new left-wing think tank. Well, can I tell you from experience, names really don't matter too much as long as you don't call yourself the Better New Zealand Initiative. So please welcome Sue Bradford. And our second panelist tonight is Sir Roger Douglas, and as a minister in two Labour governments, he really needs little introduction. He's best known, of course, for his prominent role in the radical economic restructuring in the 1980s, when the fourth Labour government's economic policy became known, of course, as Rogernomics. In 1993, Sir Roger Douglas co-founded the Association of Consumers and Taxpayers, the forerunner of the ACT New Zealand Party. He served as a Labour Member of Parliament from 1969 to 1990, and returned to Parliament as an ACT backbencher in 2008 before retiring in 2011. Please welcome Sir Roger Douglas. So the debating rules between the two of you are quite clear tonight as well. We'll invite you to share your thoughts on the debate and on the topic of the debate for approximately 5 minutes. We will not be too strict on you. And then we'll have time for a question and answer session with all of you. And I would like to start with you, Sue. The panel is all yours.
Kia ora koutou, good evening. And thank you, Oliver, and the New Zealand Initiative for inviting me along tonight. It is very much like coming into the lion's den. But thank you for having me. And I have to say that in our initiative to set up a radical left think tank, part of that is driven by the awareness that there is a lack of deep debate and policy discourse in this country, and there is really nothing, no kind of think tank or think tank-like organisation on to the left of Labour. And so it's good to see New Zealand Initiative and others here, I know, recognising that actually we need this kind of discourse and debate and deepening of policy development across the country, and that can only be good for democracy. So thanks for the invitation. Good evening, Sir Roger. Our most intimate acquaintance, if I dare be so bold, was at an election meeting in 1989 when Sir Roger was speaking at a Labour Party meeting, and our group, the Unemployed Rights Centre, invaded the hall, as we tended to do, and I seized the microphone from Sir Roger, and that was how we got to know each other. So it's good to be here in a slightly more collegial environment, as we were in Parliament together for a few years also. Anyway, to the debate. Of course, it will be no surprise which side of the debate I felt more sympathetic to. But I have to say that I find the whole use of growth as the centre of the debate is misleading, because I think that's not the main point. There is good growth, there is less good growth in terms of the effect on people and the environment, and that in some ways this concept of growth needs to be decentred. It's not, shouldn't always be the focus. From where I sit politically, the focus needs to be on what will truly nurture and sustain Mother Earth and everything around us in the natural world, and what will build and sustain social and economic justice. So I do find the MOOC difficult, and agreed with the negative speaker when he said, of course, that growth doesn't always have to be negative. For example, if we engage in sustainable farming practices, of course that is a good thing. So it is not black and white, and good points were made by both sides. I don't know about the MRI scan. Has anyone had one? They're pretty evil when you go inside them. but yes, they have their place. The first point, I thought that perhaps, especially on the positive side of the debate, there could have been more discussion about the indicators. GDP seemed to be used by both as the main indicator, but there's been a lot of work done, including by our very own Marilyn Waring here, of course, on other ways of measuring growth and measuring economic activity and the activity of a society. A lot of work's been done on that. So I was a bit surprised not to see more of that tonight. Of course, the positive, the affirmative team talked a lot about America. I too found that a bit grating because, of course, we can look to our own country to identify a lot of the context rather than looking overseas. But where I began to get really agitated was when Robert from the negative team talked about increased life expectancy in this country. Yep, well, true. But then went on to say people in this country are no longer running out of food. Well, I work now in an organisation called Auckland Action Against Poverty, which helps unemployed people and beneficiaries every day with what's happening to them down at the Work and Income Office or between work, paid work and unemployment. And we know very well that many people in this city and in this country right now do not have enough food for themselves or their children. They come to us because often for a food grant, Work and Income declines them for a food grant, they come to us. They mothers with nothing in the fridge, there has been nothing in their house for days. Their only option is a food bank or soup kitchen. We try to get them a food grant of maybe $100. The look on their face when they get that $100, because they can put food in the cupboard for a week, the look on their face is priceless. But why do we accept this in Aotearoa in 2015? Totally reject the argument there is not food poverty, there is not clothing poverty, and above all, not housing poverty in this city and in this country right now. And if any of you are on the front line or know what happens in church or social service agencies, you will know the truth of that. So that was pretty upsetting to realise that young people are not aware of that this poverty exists and that it's real, and it's not the fault of those people, it's the fault of the system that does it, which is highly unequal, and there's plenty of research on that as well. The negative team's assertion that this here in New Zealand is not an unequal society I'm trying to not use swear words. but you only have to look, for example, to a lot of the research that Max Rashbrook has done recently on inequality to see that it is in fact growing. Income inequality, wages in the workplace, the casualisation and precarisation of work, unemployment is rising and I think will rise a lot more, and housing, the huge issue, not only in Auckland but in Christchurch and in our rural districts, people having literally nowhere to live. We see families coming to us who tonight, they come today, and tonight they sleep in the park with the rest of their family or they sleep in their car. And there's no emergency housing left in Auckland. We have a major housing crisis. So again, I think these young people are either deliberately or not, or simply unaware of the realities of what's going on in this country. We have deep poverty now and it's getting worse. Is it caused by growth? Not necessarily by growth itself, but by an economy and a polity, a society that has certain values that say if you're a beneficiary, you're worth nothing. If you're a worker, you're worth not much. That does everything to incentivise the making of profits, to incentivise the wealth getting wealthier through the policies and practices of both national and Labor governments. And in creating that kind of society which prioritise the making of profit over the good of people and the good of Mother Earth, we end up in the very sad situation we are locally and internationally, where we continue to rip the earth, to destroy the oceans, and to not acknowledge the reality of climate change, of human-induced climate change, not to accept the reality of ever-deepening poverty in this country and in many other parts of the world. And I hope that these teams, particularly this team, didn't really believe what they were saying. I do realise this is a student debate. I did find it quite strange that neither team really addressed the issue of human-induced climate change. Because this is a crisis, a planetary crisis, and every country, every nation has an obligation on that. The attention to the environment in this debate was not high, as teams pointed out, but then went on to just leave it to the end. We humans do need this planet to live on. It's pretty basic, and we are destroying species every day. We are continuing to burn coal. They talked about coal, but didn't talk about actually why burning coal is really not a good idea. What coal is left should be left in the ground, because every piece of coal we're burning is heating up the planet. I mean, these really basic things were not talked about tonight. So I think that there's more that these students could be learning, but it was a fun debate. I disagreed with a lot of it. Some good points raised. Thank you very much, teams.
I really need to apologise, actually, to Sue. I do remember that meeting in Birkenhead, I think it was, in 1989, and Sue came in. I don't recall you taking the microphone, but I don't actually dispute it necessarily. And I remember that the speech I'd prepared I had to put aside and just wing it off the cuff, because I had these screaming people at the back of the room, etc. But I apologise in this sense to you, that it's the only time in my political career of 20-odd years that I managed to get my full speech in the New Zealand Herald. Oh. And I, actually, because it was a relatively serious speech that I was trying to make, whether people liked it or not, another thing, on labour market and what we should be doing about it, I was very pleased, and therefore I thank you for that, and apologise that I haven't managed to do it in the 26 years since then. The thing is, does economic growth come at the expense of people and the environment? The answer is no. It won't, unless politicians of certain persuasions actually get involved in organising or thinking that they can actually run the economy. And the last thing the negative said was essentially that we forget property rights. What's important is making that we, politicians, Greens or whatever, make the decisions. Well, if you want a disaster, get politicians to do it. Have a look at Greece for a moment. Have a look at Russia. Have a look at Poland before they found the way out, etc., etc. And if you look at the environment, I found this. It was Health of the Planet, and they asked people, because it's people, what the question is: the planet very bad or fairly bad, and what have you? And when all the countries, right from Norway down to Poland, they all are up in 78 saying the planet's not too good. When you ask them, well, what about your country? Well, all of a sudden, they came back. Instead of 70 to 80% saying it was bad, it's only 30 to 50 in most countries, a few exceptions. And when they said about your, what about your area, where you live, Norway, all the rich countries, were down at 10%. Only 10% of the people who lived there thought it was bad, the environment. When you got to Russia and Poland and South Korea and Hungary, guess what? They were still at 80. They thought the world, and I think, in a sense, that tells you something. Look, without economic development, we wouldn't have life expectancy where it is. And they talked about inequality, the negative side. The fact is that if you look at life expectancy in the less developed countries over the last 60 years has gone up by 27 or 28 years. In other words, they haven't quite doubled, but they almost have. In the developed countries, it's only gone up by about 10 to 15, 12 to 15. But, you know, if you listen to the negative, that's a terrible thing, because there's still inequality. In the less developed, they only live to 70, whereas in the developed, they live to over 80. And we better think about it. And we ought to think about why that happened. And the one thing which concerns me, and this is a real concern, is the exaggeration that we have in this debate. And that exaggeration has been going on for years. You remember when we're going to run out of food? This is from population bomb, 1970. Run out of food. The battle to feed the world is over. In the course of the 1970s, the world will experience starvation of tragic proportions. Hundreds of millions of people will starve to death. That book sold 3 million. Does it remind you about climate change? My God, it does to me. And the fact is that if you think about it, since then, we've got more food than ever. The calorie intake, especially in the developing world, has increased by over 40%. And the price of food since 19—if you compare it today with 1957—food only cost one third of what it did then. And why is that? Because the world generally has adopted the principles of economic growth. Better labour skills, technology, capital, and better economic organisation. And so, if you think about all of those things, we go on. But it's exaggeration that really worries me. Here's another quote. This is a beauty. The Global Environment Supplement from New Scientist, 2000. We humans are about as subtle as the asteroid that wiped out the dinosaurs. The damage we do is increasing. In the next 20 years, the population will increase by 1.5 billion. These people will need food, water, and electricity. Gee, that's a great statement. But already the soils are vanishing. Fisheries are being killed off. Wells are drying up. And the burning of fossil fuels is endangering the lives of millions. We are heading for a catastrophe. And the fact is that we're not running out of energy. Remember when we're going to run out of oil? My God, it's never been cheaper or more plentiful. But these same people said that we were going to run out of food. There's more food per head in the world population. Fewer people are starving. In 1900, we lived to 30. Today, we go to 67. And the UN, according to the UN, we've reduced poverty by more in the last 50 years than in the 400 or 500 years before it. And it seems to me that we need to get a little bit of realism, because the dangers of the exaggeration mean that we will have more problems than we need to have. One thing I do say is that we do need not only to get property rights into the equation, we have to start to get pricing into it as well. And if you look at some of the prior problems, say in the case of water, the problem is because we've got mad politicians who give it to some vested interest group for virtually nothing. And of course, they tend to waste it. Well, I mean, you get something for nothing, you waste it. We've done it a bit in New Zealand. And so we have to start to get not only property rights, but we need to get prices. And if we get prices in areas like transport and into areas like water, we won't have the problems we're having at the moment.
Thank you, Sue. Thank you, Sir Roger. I was pleased to see that there was a reasonable degree of disagreement between the two of you. So you played exactly according to our script. We could probably continue the debate just between the two of you, but we're actually opening it up now to you and to your question.
G'day, Oliver Broughton. I'm an energy scientist. The point I had for the negative that I thought that would have helped your argument is, I guess, the fact that one of the most energy efficient cities in the world is actually Manhattan because of the density of it. And I thought that, you know, example of economic growth to that extent, although, you know, you think of a big city like that, uses a lot of energy but per person. It's actually really good. Also, maybe ecotourism as well. It's a real eco-capitalism, I guess. Might have been another one. So, yeah.
Maybe we should check another one as well. Who would like to go ahead? I've got one there.
This is for Mr. Panellist. You mentioned that as in there was an opinion poll that said most people don't think their own country has gone bad, but when we do an opinion poll of climate change scientists, and only 95% of them, not just one book, think that anthropogenic climate change is a fact and is a very, very scary fact, do you think they're all just wrong?
What, the people?
Yeah, the climate change scientists.
No, I'm not sure. But I think it's definitely exaggerated. And I think the very fact that they've gone from calling it climate change to, what are we calling it? Global warming to climate change is an indication that their early predictions have not as yet borne fruit. Now, I'm not saying that there isn't some change, I'm not, you know, but the truth is they started off with global warming. They made all sorts of predictions which have not been fulfilled today. They now call it climate change, and I notice every time that we have a flood, it's due to climate change. God help us, did we never have floods before?
Floods of massive.
And if you listen to them, you'd have to think that we never did. But I think actually that what I quoted is actually quite interesting, because it seems to me that those who do the scare tactics, and we have had those scare tactics, we're going to run out of oil, we're going to run out of food, people are going to starve, and all that, with none of those predictions have ever come true, have caused a problem. Because if you look at all of these countries, right through from Norway, Ireland, Denmark, Finland, right down to the ones at the bottom, Russia, Poland, South Korea, and Hungary, they all are up that 70 or 80% think the world has a problem in terms of the environment. But when you ask them about their country, they come way back, or the rich ones come way back to about 20%. Russia and all those, they're still well out. In fact, some of those are out further 90% or more. But when you come back to asking them, what about where you live? None of them feel that they've got the problem, as big a problem as they have.
I had a feeling that you would like to respond.
There is a massive response that could be made on this, but I just want to pose one thing. Two places in the world. One, California, the people there, how they feel about what's happening with water right now. Secondly, the people in Tuvalu and other Pacific Islands whose total homelands are threatened by rising waters as a result of anthropogenic climate change. Those are locals in their areas affected by what's happening.
Can I point out to Dr. Bradford that the state of California, the federal government, actually controls the allocation of water in California? It's not market priced.
There's a shortage of water. Resource depletion alongside climate change are the hugest crises.
Did I see that right?
In the end of the day, if you want to look at
in many ways why some of the environmental problems occur. You only have to look at mad government policy. I mean, I go back to the 80s when I got rid of the subsidies from farming. What occurred? A lot of land that had been brought into production, marginal land that had been brought into production on the back of subsidies and low interest rate loans, etc., all of a sudden no longer were viable. So that land had to go back into forestry and or just revert it to its natural state. Now that was because politicians got in the way as the affirmative were arguing they wanted the politicians to do it rather than property rights. And another example, of course, was fishing. When we gave quotas to the fishermen, all of a sudden they changed because no longer did they want to maximise their catch. They wanted to maintain the value of their quotas. Why would you overfish if you had 10,000 tonne of quota valued at $10,000 per tonne? You'd be nuts to, and people aren't nuts. So you've got to get property rights, and you've got to get pricing in. And the other thing, keep the goddamn politicians out of it.
Is there a question there, Max? You're next. Okay, Max, go ahead. Either of you.
I just had a question for Mr. Douglas. I was just wondering, do you think inequality in New Zealand is a problem today?
Do I think inequality is a problem? I think we have to recognise why any inequality exists. And there are a number of reasons, and we better start changing some of those policies. It might take me half an hour to talk about this, but the fact is that the world over the last 20 to 30 or 30 years has changed. If you look at the world, all around the world, we have a situation where the highly skilled can be mobile and they get paid a lot more money than they did 20 or 30 years. And again, against that, the unskilled have too many people who fall into the unskilled category, and therefore the demand for their labour is not high and the wages are low, and technology has taken some of those jobs. If we want to answer that, you better change the damn school system and the university system, because it's not working. If you want to answer these problems, stop moaning about it, do something about it. And not this government or previous governments have been prepared to do it. It is a disgrace to have 30 or 40% of kids coming out of secondary school unable to read adequately or do simple maths. And until you fix that, you won't fix the inequality. So let's deal with the real guts and heart of it and stop just moaning. Some people always prefer to moan rather than do something about it.
My question to Sir, I won't even try on the inequality. I do want to ask a question in relation to environmental responsibility. And let's look at the EU under the same broad environmental protection. Would you hold up the richer countries in the EU, the Scandinavian countries, the Switzerlands and the like, as being more or less environmentally responsible than the poorest members of the EU, the Czech Republic, the former Greece, the former Eastern Bloc? I'm interested to know which end, the rich end or the poor end, are better now at protecting the environment?
I honestly don't know enough about environmental protection in places like Greece or the poorer parts of Europe. I really don't know, so I can't answer that question. But I do think that the richer parts of Europe, for example, Germany, and what's happened in Greece is a prime example of this, are not taking responsibility in their approach to Greece and to the poorer nations. They are looking after themselves, their own people, and their own environment. I'm really speaking about medical gear. And other friends, they're looking after themselves, their financial institutions in places like Germany and France, and sending Greece and its people and its country to the dogs. With the impacts that I think they will suffer from for many years.
I think Greece
sank
themselves for the dogs.
Okay, let's take that.
Hi there, I'm apologetic about dragging the discussion back to inequality, but I'm curious. So my question's for Mr. Douglas. Given that you think there are problems in the education system, and you also think that the state should have as little role as possible in what happens in New Zealand, I'm curious as to who you think is in a better position to do something about those problems that you recognise in the education system, given that you don't want the state doing anything.
Well, I think we need to change the whole welfare system, not just education, but also health and welfare. We have to move from a system that is based on taxation essentially to a system that is based on savings. We have to create a situation where individual New Zealanders like yourself have choice and the decisions are not made by the government. As long as you have a system where politicians tell you what school you have to go to or can go to, that politicians who tell you what hospital you can go to and what operation you have and when you might have it, then we're going to have trouble. And I believe we can turn the whole thing around and we can not only have a lot more economic growth, but we'll make people a lot more powerful. What we have to do is make people important. And under the present system, people who I used to represent in Otara and in Mandurah, they're not important at all. And until we have a system that makes them important, we're not going to go anywhere.
Jessica.
My question is somewhat relevant to that. It's directly around tertiary education. I would agree with you that education is a problem at the moment. Paul and I are involved in the food bank at university, and we had 8 food parcels picked up by students today who are both studying and working part-time. And if you knew the quality of our food parcels, that's really saying something at the moment. So I'm interested as to how both of you think that access to tertiary education could be improved and what a better solution to getting people here would be.
So, would you like to start?
Kia ora, and good on you for helping students in that way. And I was thinking there might be a number of people in this room that do understand food poverty and income poverty right now as you struggle through university. But in terms of access to tertiary education, I believe that we should return to a publicly funded education system right through, and that the loan scheme should be ended and that costs of going to university should be very, very low, like they were in my generation. All of us older folk here who benefit from the earlier era and now condemn younger generations to decades of debt to get the same education we were lucky enough to have when we were young. I just think it's iniquitous that intergenerational, what we've done to young people even the lowest income people that go into techs or to trade courses and have to go into debt up to the eyeballs to pay off often pretty low paying jobs, maybe no job. These are people that are left in masses of student debt, have no work on a benefit, trying to survive. I mean, that's crazy. We shouldn't be doing that to our younger generations. We should value education. It should be free or close to free. And the staff also should be treated in a very different way than they are in the neoliberal academy. One could go on.
I think I'll get closer to the door so I can run out. I don't agree at all with Sue.
Oh, surprise.
I think we've got to be realistic. the number of young people going to university has increased, and I think a lot of those, some of those young people at least, would probably be better doing apprenticeships and as electricians and plumbers and what have you. They'd earn a hell of a lot more money, and we would be better off for it. But I do not. I think there are young people from low-income families that need support. But having said that, what we are doing at university is subsidising the children of the, mainly of the most affluent in society. And we have to actually ask ourselves about fairness. Tell me why. What's fair? What is fair about giving an interest-free loan to a student or the son or daughter of a doctor earning $500,000 or more, an interest-free loan, or a big subsidy? Where is the fairness in that versus the young person that I used to represent in Otara who wants to be a truck driver and has to go to the bank and to borrow the money to purchase the truck? And because he's a bad risk, has to pay 15 or 20%. You tell me where the damn fairness of that is. Let's get out of some of our values right.
My question is directed to Dr. Bradford, but if Sir Roger wants to chime in, then feel free to.
What's up, sir?
In your opinion, Dr. Bradford, how much does government regulation exacerbate or mitigate the issues of poverty in New Zealand that you see on a regular basis?
That's way too broad and big a question to make any meaningful answer to. I will just speak to Jordan Williams in the room from the tax... But I actually agree with some of his work on the waste of taxpayers' money at times. you know, this is not necessarily a right-left divide that we're talking about here. And with regulation, I mean, we deal daily with regulation in the wealthy area, and most, I mean, we just want to chuck the one thing I agree with Sir Roger on, actually. We should chuck the current welfare system out. The Social Security law should be totally rewritten or binned, and a very different system come in. So, I'm in no way going to defend much of the law and regulation in this country, which I was busy fighting Labour for 10 years. I want it just as much as I fight National now. But it's far too complex to go into in any meaningful way. I would just say on the big questions here tonight of how, of growth and what happens with social inequality and with environmental degradation, that I certainly believe that the state, through law and regulation, should have a huge role in addressing issues of distribution and of how we protect the planet. That we need far more. The state has to take a role in that, otherwise things are just going to keep getting worse for those who have least and for the earth around us. Mm.
It is becoming, slowly, an evening of unusual coalitions. what to you?
I just wanted to draw back to the environment and the idea of growth. So with something like water rights, I think there was the example of like rights in California made earlier. Do you think it's possible to have, say, like growth within limits, where you have like regulation of water rights or assigning like water quotas, and therefore still have growth, but you know, still conserve the environment? Because from where I'm sitting, it seems like regulation can provide that.
In fact, that's the point I just made, and that's why I really wanted to say I agree with your point about sustainable farming, for example. And I mean, there's a huge problem for the environment and a massive increase in dairy, and there's other consequences happening right now with the dairy industry from the massive increase in productivity. So yes, I agree, and that's, when I talk about regulation, of course, it is a role, and charging can have a role as well.
Question here, second row, please.
Hi, this is a question for the panel.
Do you believe that relative wealth disparity is a problem at all if people at the very bottom are achieving basic level of healthcare and education and have access to food?
Do you want to answer
that question?
So, in other words, is income inequality a problem at all if people at the very bottom still have good access to healthcare, education, and can still afford food for their families, but people at the top get exponentially richer?
I think that what's important is to look at what's happening over time, relative position. I mean, if you have a movement where people in the less developed world have increased their life expectancy by 27 years in the last 30 or whatever it was, 40 years, then that's fine, that's great. It's a question of whether people are moving forward. I think that's what's really important. Are they making progress?
I didn't agree with the team that made this point about relativity, because I personally, I've spent my life working for a society in which every child that's born has the same chance of employing themselves in every way, and that means a much more equal society. Where everyone has a chance to have a good education, everyone has a chance for a decent income, and we don't have the massive disparities that we see in this country and most other parts of the world. So that does mean a deliberate deliberate mechanisms of redistribution through tax and social wage, welfare and welfare systems. Yeah. Probably not what most of the people in this room are.
Thank you. Well, I know that there are plenty more questions and we could probably debate all night, but I'm afraid that we're slowly running out of time. So I would just like to thank our two panellists tonight, Sir Roger Douglas and Dr. Sue Bradford, for their contributions. And can I just say that irrespective of your political positions, your passion is certainly missed in Parliament, and what a loss to Parliament not to have these passionate speakers there on the floor of the House. So it's really good to have you here. And just as an aside, once you're finished establishing your think tank, please invite Mr. Speaker. it is now time to find out who was the winner of tonight's debate, and I'm glad that the adjudicators have come up with their verdict, and I'm just handing over to you to explain your reasons.
I just wanted to start off by taking a moment to thank again the New Zealand Initiative for putting on this debate. I think it's an excellent initiative and a great chance to get a variety of voices or a variety of different opinions heard and a variety of audience members to come along and listen to it. So I know that I'm personally very thankful to the New Zealand Initiative for putting these events on, and I'm sure I speak for all of the debaters who are involved when I say that. And thank you all to coming along to watch as well. So I've been asked to talk briefly about how exactly we judge a debate and explain a bit of the process behind that. So I'm sorry to the debaters who will be anxiously awaiting the result, but I'm going to start by talking about that, and then I'll move to how we judge this particular debate. So as a judge, your role is quite a strange one, in that your role is to determine objectively who was the most convincing team, putting aside your own viewpoints, whether or not, you know, you like some of the people on one of the teams better, or you know, you went to the same classes, so you heard the same arguments before. The way you do that is that you look at two different points and you weigh those up. The first is the strength of their arguments, and the second is the strength of their presentation. So strength of their arguments, that's on a basic level, does what they're saying make sense? And on a more complicated level, are all of the steps in the reasoning there? Have they answered the how question? Have they answered the why question? Have they connected that back to the moot to tell me as a judge why what they're saying matters in the broader context of the debate? And then we've got this question of strength of presentation, and on a really basic level, that's whether or not you are able to understand the person who is speaking. So speed, for example, is really important there. If the debater is talking faster than you can actually listen, then obviously that's going to affect your ability to be convinced by them. A step up from that would be whether or not they make you want to listen. And so that's all your classic speech and drama things, like have they got variety in their tone rather than speaking in a monotone? Are they using soft and dark and loud and quiet? And then extra for experts is whether or not they sort of tug on the heartstrings and manage to evoke an emotive response within you such that you are more likely to want to believe what they have to say. And that's, I'm going to say we didn't really see that in this debate. It's not a debate that necessarily lends itself to that, but that can be a very convincing way to present an argument. So turning to this debate tonight, we've judged it more on matter rather than manner. We thought all of the speakers were very well presented and that there wasn't much between them in terms of their manner or their, the way they presented their arguments. So to talk through their matter then, which is, you know, debating jargon for what they had to say, their arguments, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off my analysis at a high level, then delve into the detail and come back to that high level. So on a high level then, we had an affirmative team whose argument was that growth means, or economic growth means an overriding profit motive, and that profit motive is bad. On the negating side, on the other hand, we had a team who said that growth is born out of innovation and innovation is good. So those are the two competing conceptions we had at this debate. To come down to a detailed level then, we had two points made in this debate. Firstly, the effect of growth on people, and secondly, the effect on the environment. On the question of the effect on people, we had this to and fro about whether or not the measure should be relative or absolute increases in wealth. I use wealth in quotation marks because I mean it in the broader sense of the term, happiness and well-being. The negating team managed to convince us that we are better off now than we were in Victorian England, that we are better off now than we were in the 1950s, that our quality of life overall has increased over that time period. But they weren't able to link that strongly to economic growth. On the other hand, we had an affirmative team which came up and talked about the importance of relative happiness, that it's the fact that we are happier now or that we have a greater lifespan now than we did in 1950 isn't as important as looking at some of these other points. So they talked about the fact that there is increased social immobility now than there was in the 1950s, and that because of that, that led to feelings of unworthiness and unhappiness in terms of how we judge each other, ourselves against other people. The affirmative team also talked about the fact that that inequality led to a lack of political influence, which meant there was a sense of helplessness in being able to improve your own position. And the other interesting point we had from the affirmative team was talking about how this absolute increase in happiness wasn't necessarily good for people, was talking about how innovation itself isn't necessarily always good for people because, for example, innovation under the profit motive, going back to that high level, might mean innovation to get rid of the need for labour, which means people are out of jobs, and that's not good. So on the point about people then, the negating team had convinced us that under their conception of growth as innovation, that innovation had led to increases in overall happiness, but the affirmative team had convinced us that that wasn't the end of the story, that innovation could be bad, and that this issue about relative happiness meant that people were worse off under unregulated economic growth. Turning then to the environment, which played an obvious second fiddle part in this debate, because it got left to the end of people's speeches, and as people tend to do, they run out of time because they get caught up in what they're saying in the first half of their speech. So tip to any budding debaters in the room, don't do that. On this side of the house, the affirmative team says when you've got a profit motive, that economic growth incentivizes using all of the resources that you have so that you can get the most out of them. And that is bad for the environment because it means that you don't look at those long-term issues and that things which aren't quite as material as that, like your impact on carbon emissions, aren't on your balance sheet, is something to think about. The negation team came and stood up in response to that and said, well, property rights will solve all of those problems. Unfortunately for the negating team, we didn't really understand at the end of the debate how the negating team's conception of property rights was going to address that point. We felt that some of the choices of examples by the negating team in explaining that point didn't do them any much good, like the whaling example, for example, left us with a lot of questions about ownership of whales and exactly how that would work. We think there is some really good material there, for example, talking about the carbon market and how ideas around ownership of carbon emissions and going back to the affirmative point, putting that on the balance sheet, your carbon impact. We think that there's a lot of potential there, but unfortunately it wasn't tapped into. We're not sure if that's because the negating team ran out of time or because they quite like their whaling example, but unfortunately we didn't quite get to that. So at the end of the debate then, to come back to this high level of analysis, the affirmative team were able to convince us that inherent in striving for economic growth is striving for a profit motive and an increase in consumption and production. That leads to short-term thinking, which leads to disregard for the everyday worker and disregard for the environment. The negating team, on the other hand, weren't able to show us that the profit motive was not inherent in chasing economic growth and was not able to show us that profit motive would not lead to harm and was not able to show us that innovation is in itself an answer to those concerns. And for those reasons, we gave the debate to the affirmative team, Auckland University.
Thank you very much, and congratulations to the University of Auckland, and congratulations also to the University of Canterbury for really providing a very good debate as well. Please join me in thanking both our debating teams. I'd also like to thank our adjudicators for tonight, Alex Sinclair, Joshua Baxter, and Johanna McDevitt, for not just adjudicating the debate, but actually explaining how this process works. I had a feeling you took a long time to deliberate. It must have been quite a difficult decision. So thank you very much, and please join me in thanking our adjudicators. Once again, thank you to Sir Roger Douglas and Dr. Sue Bradford for their contributions. I think you really contributed greatly to tonight's event, so thank you very much for sharing your time with us. And of course, to our sponsor, Michael Friedlander, once again, thank you very much for making this tournament possible and being such a great contributor to our debating culture. Thank you. And thank you to the University of Auckland and the Business School for hosting us tonight. Thank you to Robert McCulloch for organizing this for us. It's great to be here, and we hope to be back next year. Thank you for that. And finally, thank you to my colleague, Chelsea Blair, who helped to organize this whole debate for the New Zealand Initiative. That's all for tonight. Next week, of course, is the grand final. It will be fought in Wellington on Auckland property prices. In a way, it's good to have the University of Auckland there, at least. And the Moot next week will be that this House believes that a nation cannot get richer on the back of rising property prices. We'll have two expert panellists as well. They will be marginally different, as always. So we'll have Labour's housing spokesperson, Phil Twyford, and he will debate with Andrew King from the Property Investors Federation, so that should be quite a lively debate in itself. You're all invited. If you happen to be in Wellington next week, please come along. If not, we'll video the event for you. But for tonight, please thank you very much for coming, and please follow the work of the New Zealand Initiative, and I hope to see you at one of our next events. Thank you.